once again, I welcome you all. As you know, that these sessions are being organized by India International Education Council and School Lalaji Solutions. India International Education Council is a not-for-profit organization which is working in the field of education. It has collaborators from 12 countries. It aims to create a better world through education. It is also building quality centers for elementary education, approachable for all kids, finding the best educational practices across the globe, and find ways to implement those in Indian institutions. It is also creating more awareness on hygiene and learning disabilities. It publishes a magazine called World Education Review and many other educational reports. It aims to build 100 chapters in different cities by 2022. It will soon open its membership for institutions and individuals. It also imparts training for leaders, teachers, students, and parents. So as you know that so far we have conducted 141 sessions. We have received 17,376 registrations, 16,193 questions. We have received participation from 7 countries, India, USA, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Nepal, Kuwait, and Russia. From India, we have seen participation from 22 states and 119 cities. We aim to organize minimum 200 sessions. With this, we would be reaching out to 100,000 educators, 20,000 institutions, and 1,000 plus eminent speakers. Like today's speakers would be joining us to share their perspective and thoughts on national education policy. So with this, I would request you all please join me in welcoming our key speakers for this very special session. Our first key speaker, Dr. Rajesh Sharma ji. Rajesh ji is principal with the Vinayan Public School, Bhopal, Madhya Pradesh. His mission, he is passionate to prepare quality leaders for tomorrow, dedicated to the mission of being the facilitator to teachers, students, and parents. He started his teaching career from Air Force School, Gwalior, as a PGT psychology and school counselor in 1998. He has been principal with various reputed CBC schools. I believe my screen is visible to all. If Dr. Yadav, if you can confirm me, is my screen visible? Anwar ji, meri screen
dikhai de. I can see a W written there. Is that your screen? I can't see a presentation or something like that.
Okay. There is some challenge.
Your screen is visible, but it is not in presentation mode, I think.
Is it visible now?
Yes. Now it is visible.
Right. So I'm really sorry.
Yes,
for
it
that.
Is visible.
So our first key speaker for this very special session, Dr. Rajesh Sharma ji. Dr. Rajesh is the principal with Vinayan Public School, Bhopal, Madhya Pradesh. He is passionate to prepare quality leaders for tomorrow, dedicated to the mission of being the facilitator to teachers, students, and parents. He started his teaching career from Air Force School, Gwalior. He has been principal with various reputed CBC schools like APS Bhopal, ITS Bhopal, CareRx Public School Ahmedabad, and Bal Bhavan School Bhopal. He is also the CBSE Master Trainer, MPanel for CCE, Life Skills, Gender Sensitization, Classroom Management, Happy Classrooms, Re-Model Assessment System, Career Guidance. He's received various prestigious awards like Best Teacher Award in 2004 at A4 School Gwalior. Computer literacy brought to this school by the government of India, by the then president of the Avantika Guru Dronacharya Samman, awarded by Bharat Vikas Parishad, Avantika Sarla Chopra Samman. He also received a CBSE appreciation from the CBSE chairman, the National Sahodia Principal Conference at Bhopal 2008. He was also awarded for his academic excellence by Gyan Ganga Society Bhopal. He has also received Educators Award 2018 by Maharishi World Peace Movement, Bhopal, Madhya Pradesh. We welcome you, Dr. Rajesh ji. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you. Our next speaker, Honorable Education Leader Sudipta Dutta ji. Sudipta ma'am is principal with Ashoka Global Academy, Nashik. She is a pragmatic leader with a vision to bring about transformation in the education system with an experience of more than 20 years in the field of education. Swipta ma'am has traversed an experiential journey from an innovative educator to a progressive leader. She thrives on the principles of practicalism, implementation of design thinking in the teaching learning process, as well as administration, along with the new age technology, has been her signature approach. She has been an educator with various curricula, starting from state boards to national curricula. She has worked as an associate IBDP coordinator, theory of knowledge coordinator, an IB mathematics examiner, and internal assessment moderator. She has been a workshop leader and teacher trainer, working as a leadership coordinator. She has been working with International Education for the past 12 years, being part of various workshops and led webinars for the International Leaders Community. We welcome you, Swipta ma'am. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Welcome, ma'am. Our next speaker, another very senior education leader, Anurag Gupta ji. Anurag ji is Director and Chief Mentor with Vidya Niket School, Gwalior, Madhya Pradesh. Anurag ji holds a Bachelor of Engineering Computer Science from RGPV, India, and Master of Science, MS from Digital Communication from Monash University, Australia. He's also done MBA from Great Lakes Institute of Management, India, and BEd from Jeevaji University, India. Anurag ji is an Australian citizen of Indian origin and holds an overseas citizen of India status. Prior to starting Vidya Niket, Anurag ji served in the IT and telecom industry in India and abroad for a long time. Having stayed and worked in different parts of the world, he has vast international exposure and brings a lot of innovation to the field of value-based education system. Apart from teaching and managing academic institutions, his interest greatly lies in the field of teachers' training and development. He's a CBSE-certified master trainer and a peer assessor for SQAA and consultant for CBSE-related matters. We welcome you, Anurag sir. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you.
Thank you for calling me, sir. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. My pleasure.
Welcome, sir. I'll come back to you. Our next speaker, another very senior education leader, Johan Kovar ji. Johan ji is principal with Vidya Bhavan Public School, Bareilly, Uttar Pradesh. He's a senior education leader with decades of experience. He has worked with many prestigious schools. He has been awarded and recognized for his contribution to the field of education many times. We welcome you, Johan sir. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you.
Thank you, sir. I'm sorry because I'm not well. So after 10 minutes, I'm going to join continuously. Please only allow me only 10 minutes. Thank you, sir. No problem, sir. I'll be in the group only. I'll continue in after 10 minutes, please. Thank you.
No problem, sir. No problem. Thank you. Our next key speaker, Dr. Manoj Yadav ji. Dr. Yadav is assistant professor with SRM University, Haryana. He is a principal investigator of SERB, Government of India funded project on drug repurposing against COVID-19. He's also the honorary fellow of Society of Life Sciences from National Society of Life Sciences, India. He has qualified CSIR National Eligibility Test twice and also qualified for a graduate aptitude test in engineering. He is also the member of editorial board and reviewer of many peer-reviewed journals. He has published his research work in 19 journals of international repute and also written one book and two book chapters of international publishers. Welcome you, Manoj ji. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you.
Thank you very much, Rajul ji, for inviting me to share my views.
Thank you, sir. Thank you and welcome. I'll come back to you. And a last key speaker for this very special session, another very senior EdTech leader, Jaswinder Singh ji. Jaswinder ji is founder and CEO of Wordsworth ELT. Jaswinder ji has an experience of 30 years in the field of education and technology and has also served as a consultant to UNESCO on education. Wordsworth English Lab is designed for India and is highly research initiative of ACT UNIP Group. It is a trusted education company with 2 decades of service in technology, education and training. Its expertise in technology, multimedia and content development has been instrumental in presenting a world-class language lab solution for academia in India. In a short span of time, Wordsworth English Language Lab has managed considerable recognition across the country for its unique content and methodology. Over 3,000 installations and institutions across the country stand testimony of the quality in product, implementation, training, and the continual service provided by the ACT-UNIF and its committed network of dealers. We welcome you, Jaswinder sir. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you. With this, I once again thank you all for joining us. And we come to the next part of the session, which is the opening remark part. I would be requesting all our key speakers if we can have your 1 minute opening remark. So I would first request Dr. Rajesh Sharma ji. Rajesh sir, if we can have your quick 1 minute opening remark. Sir, you are on mute. Rajesh sir, you are on mute.
Oh, yes. Now, sorry for that. Thank you and good morning, everyone. It's a fantastic, you know, to have discussion done on NEP, because this is something today, the latest is how we are going to have competency-based evaluation with the British Council. The CBSE has come up with that yesterday. So NEP is going to be, as a matter of fact, transformational step which will change the scenario of education in India. That's what I'm looking forward to. Thank you, Mr. Raju.
Thank you, Rajesh sir. We all are very excited to hear your ideas in detail. I'll come back to you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I would request Sugita ma'am. Ma'am, if we can have your 1 minute opening remark.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I just wanted to add, to what Rajesh ji just said, that NEP is a revolutionary concept, and the whole idea has come, taking into consideration the curricula and the educational systems that are existing across the world. It is clearly visible in the whole document, where it has taken aspects from various curricula, and the best part is that they have blended very well with the national scenario. So it is going to be a revolutionary concept, and every revolutionary concept takes time to materialize. So definitely it is going to take time, but very, very positive move is what I feel.
Thank you, ma'am. I'll come back to you. Now I would request Anurag sir, sir, if you can have your ideas, your opening remark.
Jai Hind, good morning. It's 11:15. Actually, I am on inspection in Kendri Vidyalaya, so I'm sitting in the garden, and because there's the only place where you get signals. So there might be some noise, so please excuse me for that, because that meeting came up just yesterday only. Thank you for calling me here. Dr. Rajesh, namaskar. Anurag here. And namaskar to everyone who's present here. We have a lot of stalwarts in this. But the thing is, what I am worried about, seen the NEP, we have read the NEP, we have seen the draft. But the biggest challenge that we'll be facing is so it's too early to say anything right now. We need to, as what I am concerned or what I am is we just need to wait and watch about how we go forward with this, because the things which are incorporated in the, no doubt about it, but there's certain things that we need to work upon, and that problems will arise when we start working on putting something on paper and actually implementing it. It's a different story altogether. So it's too early to decide what is good, what is bad. It is good in nutshell, it is good, no doubt about it, but if the implementation is not in a better way, then everything will go in vain. So we need to work out on the roadmap how we can implement it properly. Because there are certain things which are not clear to many of the stakeholders. So we just have to wait and just start it in a phased manner, and then we can come up with problems and then the solutions. So this is what my take is. Thank you.
Thank you, Anurag sir. I'll come back to you for detailed perspective, and I, please accept my special thank that you have you still joined us. You are on your inspection, still you have joined us. Big thanks, sir. So now, I believe Johan sir
will be
joining us. Johan sir will be joining us in next moment, as he said in the beginning. So I would request Dr. Yadav, Manoji, if we can have your opening remark.
Yes, definitely, Rajil. Good morning, all of you. Okay, so today is the discussion of National Education Policy. So my short view is that it is a well drafted document that is prepared by eminent scientists K. Kasturi Rangan, and basically I am going to talk how it impacts on our higher education systems. What are the important points that is drafted for the higher education in India? Okay, so I am going to discuss those points in my talk.
And thank you, Dr. Indra, for joining. Big thanks. I'll come back to you. Sir. Now I would request Jasminder sir, sir, if you can have your opening remark.
Yeah, good morning, everybody. I'm slightly late, I'm sorry. Okay, so I come from the EdTech part of the world. I have worked with some of the schools where we have got principals from these places. So basically, NEP 2020 talks about a lot of inclusion of technology, and there's a little change that they're bringing in the way education is going to be delivered when we talk about languages. So my total focus is going to be how do we use technology to our benefit, and what happens to the local language, or how is it going to be implemented? What are we going to do? How is language going to be impacted by this NEP 2020? So that's what my focus is going to be. Thank you.
Thank you, Jasminder sir. For that, I'll come back to you for detailed perspective. I here would like to check if Johan sir has joined us back. Johan sir, do we have your presence now?
Yeah, already I'm in the group. Actually, I'm sorry. Actually, I'm at home today. I'm really sorry again. Actually, yesterday I was suffering from fever, so I'm late today. I'm sorry. Yes, I have gone through all this kind of NEP and all.
Can we have your opening remark, sir?
Pardon?
Sir, your opening remark.
Yeah, I'm at home. Sorry. Once again. Yes, good morning, everybody. In my what I have seen, that the NEP is really fantastic and good idea. And but one thing I'm always in doubt ki whether we can apply in practical life also. There are many schools in village area, they cannot use the technology properly, but in cities school they can use technology. There's a big issue, big challenge, because in 2009 when CCE pattern came, so many schools started applying that kind of CCE pattern but failed. I have seen many schools could not apply also. Then another in 2016 new changes. Now again this time big changes has come, but the practically whether we are ready or not, that's very kind of challenging. Thank you. I'll join you later on. Please continue.
Thank you, Johan sir. I'll come back to you for your detailed perspective. And with this, we come to the next part of the session, which is the main talk part. I would be inviting all our key speakers for their detailed perspective. But before I invite our first key speaker, I just would like to share the learnings which we have had during our last 141 sessions. You know, during our last 141 sessions, almost all the participants shared that this is a wonderful document. This document has a potential to place India at that coveted position of Vishwa Gyan Guru. But at the same time, almost same number of participants shared this document is going to be very, very challenging to execute. This is such an ambitious document. A lot of people shared various challenges. Many people said that finance is going to be a key concern area. Other people said the teacher's training is an area of concern. Many people said that yes, teacher's training is an area of concern, but the bigger area of concern is lack of intent among teachers to get trained. A lot of people who participated shared their assessment that this pandemic has exposed how poor distribution we have in our country for the digital infrastructure. That is going to be another big challenge. A lot of people, a lot of participants shared that, you know, good schools in urban areas already implementing many of these ideas. So the biggest challenge would be for the rural schools, budget schools, and, you know, government schools. So I would request all our key speakers that while sharing your perspective, while sharing your interpretation, if you can also suggest some idea, some best practice which you have been implementing in your respective institution. So that would make this session more engaging, more useful for all of us, and we can learn from each other. I would also request to all of you that please keep the time limit in mind, that 8 to 10 minutes per speaker, so that we have sufficient time in the end for the questions. So now with this, I would invite our first key speaker, Dr. Rajesh Sharma ji. Rajesh sir, over to you.
Thank you so much, Rajan. And I must again tell you that this is something which I feel is a document. And just for the information of all the listeners, you know, I have been master trainer for CCE when it started, right, from 2007. Okay, so And you will be surprised when in 2016 I was taking CC training when I got the information that no more CC training to be done. And to tell you honestly, my personal feeling, CC is a very good concept. I still would like that CC to be followed. It failed because of no training of the teachers. Because the misinterpretation, because teachers did not understand the system, and that's where it failed. The same, I'm sure, as you were sharing, many of the educationists must have shared that apprehension that if we do not, you know, support it with the teachers' training, this will also fall flat on the face. Yeah, so my thinking is the plan is absolutely fine. And as a, you know, I am a very positive person, being a psychologist, I always think on the growth part of it. As with a growth mindset, I am expecting that we will be able to, you know, do good things, maybe not immediately 100%. I just want to share 1 minute story of, you know, one Japanese. As a matter of fact, Gorbachev wrote it in his memoirs that when he was taking education in Europe, there were two Japanese students in his class. Okay, so during the class, one friend will write with a pencil and another fellow will keep sharpening the other pencil because the pencil was so weak that it will break in between every sentence. So the one of the fellow, he asked, why are you using your Japanese pencil? Why don't you use the other country? They have a strong pencil, good one. They told, if we do not purchase our own country-made things, nobody else will purchase and we will make a better one after using only. We come to know the deficiency only after use. So my thinking is, as an educationist, as a principal of this school, I am going to try my best to put it in action. Maybe the pencil needs to be sharpened. It's okay. It happens. So let us implement whatsoever best we can do. You know, you can transform the situation only by taking action. And thinking without action is a disease. Let us come out of it. Okay, there can be pros and cons. There will be some hitches. There will be some, you know, slips or fall downs. It's okay. It is always understood Rome was not built overnight. We are doing, after 34 years of gap, we got the NEP. So let us try with an honest effort. And this is where the all stakeholders have to come together. I understand the CCA training or different kind of training, teachers training, as a matter of fact, here the stakeholders have to understand that we are working for whole nation. Let us not restrict only thinking of my school. It is a generation, you know, the generation of the nation is built in the school. So we are doing that work. Let us try, work it out and give our best shot. Because then only we will be able to achieve our national aim and the education which we are trying to do. So my suggestion that let all of us try our best as an educationist and wherever we are. You know, the success doesn't need wo normal tail hoga to radha nachegi. Please let us come out of that concept. Jahan par hain, jaise hain, jitni resources hain, let us work it out and give a best shot. Thanks again, Mr. Rajul, for giving me. I just would keep the time tag surely. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Rajesh, sir, also highlighted these points. You know, we agree with you, and in fact, a lot of educators have shared the similar views that CC was also a good initiative, very good initiative, in fact, but got failed due to poor execution and poor training, as you mentioned. You also called upon all the educators that NEP needs honest and dedicated efforts from all of us for its successful implementation. So a big thanks, Rajesh, for joining and sharing these important parts. You, in fact, save time for others as well. So big thanks once again. So now I'll come back to you with questions, sir.
Yeah.
Now, I would request Sudipta ma'am, if we can have your perspective in detail. Sudipta ma'am.
Yes, I would like to share the screen if you can give me a second. Yeah. Just please let me know if you can see the screen.
Not yet.
I am trying to.
Ma'am, you click on window and open the window that you want to show.
Okay.
So you go on present now, click on a window, and when, yeah, that's it, ma'am.
Okay, thank you so much.
Coming up. Yeah, ma'am.
Yes, thank you. So I would like to start here with this aspect that, as I already shared with you, that you know, the national education policy that we see and we, when we read it, it is very clear that it comes from a very clear perspective of engulfing policies from different education systems, policies from different countries, successful education systems like Finland, successful education systems like Cambridge, IB, a lot of aspects, and I being, you know, privileged to be a part of all these education systems for a very long time, I have been able to understand that it is a very, very positive move in making, the national policy of education in line with the international system. Now, in various parts of this policy, we can see that the aspect of encouraging people from outside the country to come and study in India, to create a blend, to create a harmony amongst the education systems that are existing across the world, is the main aim of this policy. Now, in my presentation, I've tried to cover certain aspects which are going to be effective in implementing. Now, as I have implemented these things in my regular teaching learning for a very, very long time, I would be giving this as a suggestion to whether it can be taken or not, that is up to the people, but I feel that it is possible to implement it even with minimum resources. So it is just the approach which has to change. It is the mindset which has to change. So if you're starting with, let's have the audience to, mute. Excuse me.
Yes, ma'am, it has been done.
Yes, thank you so much. So now this is the pedagogical structure which is suggested by the National Education Policy, where we talk about the various stages, the foundational stage, the preparatory stage, the middle and the secondary stage. Now, all of you might be knowing that this is the same kind of a pattern which is existing in most of the international systems. So when working with the international system, it had made a lot of sense in bringing that spiral approach in teaching learning. So when we are talking about the pedagogical structure, these are the main highlights of the pedagogical structure that we are looking at. It talks about competency-based education, integration of subjects, development of scientific temper, no silos, that means teaching subjects as integrated with co-curricular and curricular activities, emphasis on digital literacy and promotion of multilingual teaching. So in a nutshell, these are the aspects which have been covered in the pedagogical structure. In my presentation, I'm covering only this part of it, which is the point four of curriculum development, curriculum integration of essential subjects and skills. And that's what I'm covering in this. So ideas to implement. Now, I've straight gone on to the fact that these are the ways we can implement it. First is the spiral learning approach. Now, obviously, with the same approach in the curriculum or with the same kind of textbooks or with the same kind of mindset, national education policy will not be possible to implement. So we have to change the approach. How to change it? spiral learning is something which is a policy over, you know, in a lot of curricula. Now, spiral learning means that even when a child is studying in, say, grade one, whatever the child is learning, the next stage is just one notch ahead of it. But the same concepts are wound across the entire curriculum. It just goes on developing one notch ahead of it. So spiral learning is an approach which helps link the entire curriculum, the vertical linkage between all the entire curriculum. And this helps in the smooth transition from one stage to the next. In each stage, the child builds on previous learning, a spiral approach that reinforces what the student has learned while at the same time they take it forward from there. So one notch ahead, as I said. Now, to develop a curriculum that suits students' context, culture, ethos, so the curriculum has to emphasize on these aspects. Where does the child come from? Now, if the teaching learning process only focuses on a particular regional bias or only focuses on the urban lifestyle, does not take into consideration the child's context or the culture or the ethos that the child comes from, then that curriculum will not work. So it has to be developed keeping all this in mind. Now, how does the holistic development of learners happen, which is the second point in this pointer? It talks about deep subject knowledge. Now, to develop a deep subject knowledge, the things which have to be incorporated is the ability to solve problems. So problem-solving approach. So every problem, every subject has to be taught with a problem-solving approach rather than a top-down kind of an approach. So you are giving them all the materials and they are just, learning from it is not going to help. Give them problems which they are unaware of, unknown things. That has to be the approach right from the very beginning. If that approach changes, the deep subject knowledge will improve. Develop conceptual understanding. No content-based teaching anymore. Content-based teaching has happened over a period of time where we only look at various topics which are to be taught. So develop higher order thinking, choice and flexibility is also being brought in, where a lot of subject choices are to be implemented. I understand that in the national scenario, when we're looking at some villages or in certain areas where choice and flexibility is difficult to give. But there we can talk about vocational training, where it is more important for the child to learn vocational things. A child learns agriculture, a child learns about carpentry. That has relevance to the child's life if the child is coming from that kind of a background. So these kind of subject areas can be brought in, subject experts, easy to get, because you will always get a person who is, an agriculture expert or a carpentry expert. So it is easy to do that with local resources itself. Challenges that I see, yes, using mother tongue as a medium of instruction, somewhere it is a challenge, somewhere it is a boon. If we only stick to the mother tongue, we will not get resources everywhere based on that mother tongue. So we will have to do a blended approach where mother tongue can be a medium of instruction, but the child has to also learn reading, writing, and in the required instructional language. So that has to be brought, a balance has to be brought in. Reduction in curriculum is not an option. I feel it is no way an option, because that is going to definitely impact the higher studies. So the base, as I said, deep subject knowledge, the way the curriculum is approached will matter. Multilingualism, again, it talks about the same. I'm not going to probe too much on that, but professional development of teachers for multilingual teaching is very important. So that is something which I would really like to stress on. It is not only about telling the teachers that you have to use a multilingual approach. How does a teacher know how to use a multilingual approach? So there comes the hurdle of having the correct kind of professional development. curriculum development through scaffold learning, through connect in real world, learning to learn, mentors as teachers, all this we've been hearing for a very, very long time. I don't think that it is very difficult to implement, because the people who have been going through CBSE, even ICSE now, are all being trained on these aspects. So it is possible that even the state boards can take up this concept, you know, very easily. So I only wanted to stress on these few factors, looking at the fact that it is possible, it is being done, it is being implemented in various places with the minimalistic resources. If we look at the experiential schools that are existing, you know, there are many schools in the villages, the unique concepts which have been implemented without using very exorbitant infrastructure. So the fact that that is possible in those schools is the fact that it can be made possible anywhere that we look at. Only our approach, our positive approach towards the whole policy has to come. So this is what I would like to share. Thank you.
Thank you, Sudipta ma'am, for sharing these important points with us. You know, you began by saying that NEP is a revolutionary initiative. It has potential, you know, to bring that much desired changes in Indian education system. And, you know, you explained how this has the potential to transform those curriculum and pedagogy, which is talking about, you know, you explained those competency-based education system where we are going to. You also talked about ideas to implement a new pedagogical structure. You explained that spiral learning and how this should be implemented, how what benefits it offer. You also talked about where NEP is promising that holistic development of our learners. You also talked about the benefits and the potential of multilingualism and the power of language. And in the end, you talked about the process of curriculum development and the potential of it. And in the end, you called upon all the educators that we need to adopt a positive approach towards the execution of this policy, and certainly these all ideas can be implemented. New resources are secondary, attitude is the first which we need to adopt. So big thanks to Sudipta ma'am for sharing these important points. I would come back to you with questions. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
And now with this, I would invite Anurag Gupta sir. Anurag sir, if you can have your ideas in detail. Anurag sir.
Certainly, but I'll be keeping my talk constraints of time, my time, because I'm in between of the inspection. I just came when I have to speak. Though ma'am has already shared everything, the Bible of NEP, so I don't have to add much to it. A few things I just want to make everyone understand. That what I think is with slight changes, this NEP has come. We were supposed to do all that previously also. If and the circular in the year of 2001, 2003, 2004 and 2005, find a lot of things emphasizing on vocation. You see a lot of things emphasizing on value education. Yes, there were some. Now they have come up openness for all things. Like from 9th onwards, you can have. Whatever subject you want to take, you can. That is a new thing that has come up with the NEP. The best thing which I like, apart from whatever about regarding the vocational education or freeness of subjects, flexibility of choosing careers and all that, is it has specifically mentioned value-based education in black and white. This is the best, I think, this NEP has right now. They've talked about values like truth, peace, non-violence, love, righteous conduct, and all that, which is very much required in today's education. This can be acquired at any point of time. If you do it at the primary stage or in the formative stage, it's good, but they can be acquired at any point of time. But values, once they are developed in the early ages, certainly will take them long. So the best part, which I think NEP has right now, is the value education part, and it has to be implemented very, very seriously. If you're successful in doing that, the value education part, if you're successful in doing that, rest everything will follow it, and it will be very, it's a piece of cake in that case. Everything else can be easily incorporated in the system, because these things were already there in the system. If you see all those things which we have done in the past, these things are already there in the system. So this is what I want to say, that value education is a need of the country at this point of time. So I normally call it new, instead of calling it new education policy, I call it new ethics policy, because this is what we require at this point of time in our country like India. Policy document that talk about ethics and integrity in workplaces, in schools, in personal lives. So this is my take on it, that this is the best part. Apart from, you have a very good system that would be coming up to teach in the local languages or regional languages, which is very important, because normally what happens is in every developed country that we talk about, you have education in their native languages. So why can't we have education in our native languages? Why we emphasize more and more and more and only one language, that is English? So ma'am, abhi hum angrezi mein hi baat kar rahe hain, to main hindi mein bolna chahunga. Jab ye local languages ka bar, wo English ka bar hat jayega, aur sare courses jo regional languages mein available hona shuru ho jayenge, rozgar bahut badh jayega, reach badh jayegi logon ki education ke sath. Agar hum isko implement kar lete hain, to bahut khoobsurat baat hogi. So this is what I want to say. I have to take your leave now. I wish all of you a very good luck. Thanks, Rajesh sir, for your wonderful thoughts. Thanks, ma'am. So it was a pleasure listening to you and the organizers for this meet. I have to rush because there's a meeting from with the brigadier, so I have to go there. But yes, it was a wonderful session. And Rajesh sir, nice to see you again. And we'll
thank
be
you.
In touch,
thank
sir.
You, Adrak, and all the best.
Thank you.
You're doing great. Please keep doing good. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, sir.
You talked about that value-based education, which is in need of the country at this important time. You also talked about how this NEP is talking about those, you know, ethics, those, you know, values you explained. And then in the end, you also shared your assessment that NEP's focus on regional languages is laudable. So big thanks, Anuragji. Now, I believe Johan sir has lost the connection. Johan sir, do we have your presence? I believe he has lost the connection. So, Manoj Jadav ji, Manoj sir, if we can have your ideas.
Okay, thank you. I would like to share my screen. Okay. Just wait a minute. The screen is visible?
Yes, sir.
So, my today's presentation means consists of 12 to 13 slides. I think those number of slides are more. So, I'm just giving the overview. What are the policy documents that are placed in the national education policy? How they transform the higher education? Okay, so I am just giving a simplified snapshot of higher education in India, how our higher education is going to transform from the current state to the upcoming state. So I think this is my personal view. This is my personal view that the main motto of this NEP 2020 is to educate, to encourage and to enlighten the society. Okay, so what is the need of this NEP 2020? We have before NEP 2020, we have some other drafts are also available, and they have some different objectives and different aim. Just like we have Kothari Education Commission in 1964. Okay. And their aim is to just spend 6% of our GDP on the education. Okay, so this type of goals are set for different education policies. So this education policy has its own goals and objectives. So what is the need of that? We are preparing our students for those kind of jobs that are not existing today. Means most of nowadays what happens, most of the jobs are technology based, and that technology is changing day by day. Okay, so there are some jobs we have no idea today, but definitely those kind of jobs exist in the future. Think of an example, like we have a pandemic last year, that is COVID-19. Okay, so from past 100 years, our scientists know that at one point of time, a pandemic is going to come, but they have no idea on which time. But just think of that, in 2017, one international collaboration is established in order to tackle the future diseases, that are diseases going to happen in future. So these type of things we have to prepare for things. For that, this is NEP 2020 is a wonderful draft, and you can say that this is a one step in that direction. Okay, so what is the core theme of NEP 2020? We want to reach the 6% of the GDP. Still we are very far behind for that percentage. I think if I am correct, nowadays we are spending around 4 to 4.5% in our education. So this is long term or short, you can say that at this stage this is a short term goal, but definitely this is a long term goal, and we have to do a lot in order to achieve that. Okay, so in perspective of higher education, we have some old regulatory frameworks are there. So what is happening in the NEP 2020? These old regulatory framework, like that we have committee UGC, AICT, for dealing with different kind of educations. If we are dealing with the university level, we have UGC. If we are dealing with the engineering college level or engineering curriculums, we have AICT. So what happens in NEP 2020? They are going to create a single organization. That is HECI, means Higher Education Council of India. All the different committees works under this single organization. Okay, the next slide is, you can just see what comes, what are the verticals that comes inside the HECI. So for the different kind of task, we have different councils, like for in order to get the regulatory affairs, we have National Higher Education Regulatory Council for giving the accreditation. We have NAC for funding the education as well as the research. We have Higher Education Grants Council, and for taking care of the academic standards, we have another framework, that is National Higher Education Qualification Framework. And all these frameworks work under the single umbrella, and that is Higher Education Commission of India. So by using this kind of structure, we are decentralizing the policies, decentralizing the things, so that independent body can handle independent type of task. Okay, so why this is essential? This is essential because in order to decrease the paperwork also. Otherwise, you think that if suppose we want funding for research, for higher education, so we have to do a lot of paperwork. So these comes under the single umbrella. Definitely, they will cut the paperwork. And okay, so another important aspect is that in higher education, NEP 2020 proposes three types of institutions. One is research, next is teaching, and autonomous degree granting ones. And apart from that, they are interested in new multidisciplinary institutions. Nowadays, what is happening in the traditional level, one maths professor is teaching mathematics, other physics professor is teaching physics, you know. So there are specialized things, but in the current scenario, when we are dealing with the with some kind of problems, then we have to use the multidisciplinary approach. Okay, for that a person should be expert in all the subjects so that he can think of something new. So for that they are want to establish different types of organizations, and the one important aspect is academic bank of credit, that is ABC. This is also very important transformation that underlies in the NEP 2020. So what is this basically? What happens if a student is undergrad student is going to take admission in any BTech program, then they have to earn some credits in order to get the BTech degree or MTech degree. Okay, so in the current scenario, if suppose I have taken admission in SRM University, okay, so I have to complete, I have to earn all my credits in the same university, or you can say that I am bound to study in this university until and unless I will get the degree, I will get the BTech degree. So you can say that means this is this kind of means forced learning is this. If suppose what government thinks, government is thinking that suppose government is saying that for getting a BTech degree you have to earn suppose 61 credits. So what you can do, you can earn these credits from any place. Suppose in SRM, that bioinformatics part is very good. So what you do, you earn some credits of bioinformatics from SRM. In the IIT, they are very good with some AI and machine learning techniques. So you just take some credits from there, and those credits are digitally stored in your account, similar to your bank account. And after the sum of all the credits will become 61, you will get the BTech degree. Simple thing. So there is more freedom for the student level, and there is high level challenge for the teachers. Means their teachers and universities have to make their curriculum at a high level, competitive level. Okay, so apart from that, one aspect is that NEP is thinking of allowing 100 foreign universities, 100 foreign top level universities, okay, they can be allowed to set up their campus in India and will be given the permission, regulatory permission, governance permissions. And these foreign universities are part of teaching and research programs. In the same way, NEP 2020 is going to phase out the affiliated colleges. Okay, and affiliated college will become the independent colleges, and they will be graded on the basis of merit. What academic merit, what administrative merit, and what are the financially merits they have. On the basis of that, they will give the accreditation, they will get the funding, and this is one of the important aspect of that. And another is the National Research Foundation. What happens if we have to get the funding? We have DST, we have SERB, we have UGC. So what is implemented in NEP 2020, they have just established a single foundation. All type of research related fundings, you have to apply to the National Research Foundation. Okay, and for the undergraduate education, 4-year multidisciplinary bachelor's degree program will be there, and this is more flexible. It has multiple exit points. What happens previously, if you have take admission in a bachelor degree and somehow due to time constraint or due to financial constraint, you are not completing the degree up to 3 years, or for the BTech it is 4 years, then you will not be awarded the degree. So that 2 year or 3 years of your time is wasted. So what happened here in the NEP 2020, they have proposed that there must be a multiple exit point. If you a student want to exit just after 1 year, then he or she will be awarded with a certificate. If after 2 years, then diploma. If 3 years, then bachelor's degree. If he or she is completing the all the 4 years, then he or she will get the bachelor degree with the research. Okay, and one of the most confusing part, or you can say that the rumor is that our traditional 3 year courses is going to vanish. So this is false. This is just a rumor. Traditional courses will also exist in parallel with these, the advanced degree programs. And on the post-graduation level, a student with a 3 year bachelor degree can pursue 2 year master program. Okay, so this is just see, I think my cursor is visible. Hello.
Sir, your slides are not changing because you have not chosen the right window. You are still on slide number 2.
Oh, sorry.
I'll tell you what you've done is when you select, you have to go on to the other part of, there are 2 PowerPoints open on your screen.
Yes. Sorry. I think there is only single PowerPoint, na?
There should be one but you have clicked. See, when you present it, you have the original file and the presentation file. When you open the window, you have opened the presentation one, but the original one is being seen here. Now there's nothing.
Wait. I am thinking that my slides are visible. wait a minute. Now it is visible.
Yes, your screen is visible, sir. Can you just try to change your slides?
Yeah, you are on the 10th slide, sir.
Okay.
Yes,
so, now you're visible. So most of that part is completed without those slides. Okay, no problem. So what happens at the higher education level, in the graduation level and post-graduation level, NEP 2020 proposes some suggestions. So what happens at the post-graduation level? Draft is saying that if a student has a 3 year bachelor degree, then it can go for master program of 2 years. But if that a student, any student have 4 years bachelor's degree. So 4 year bachelor's degree means you have bachelor's degree along with the research. So for getting the master degree, you have to just complete 1 year program. So you can say that this is a kind of integrated programs. Okay, and the most important part is that the MPhil program is going to be discontinued. Okay. So what happens after completing your master's? Some students will go for the MPhil program, 1 year MPhil program. Later on, they will take admission in their research for getting the PhD degree. Now that NEP 2020 proposes, there is no MPhil program. It is just a bachelor program, master program, and then directly PhD program. Okay, so these type of suggestions are there in NEP 2020. And I am very much in favor of mother tongue for teaching the student. Because what happens when you see the foreign countries like China? China is doing very good in school level education as well as in the research level education. Okay, and they are teaching their students in a you can say that in their mother tongue, and even at higher education level, they have their own literature, they have their own subject literature, and they are learning all the research concepts, they are learning all their teaching concepts in the Chinese language. If we even think of that, they are writing the research papers in Chinese language, and they are publishing international journals. Nowadays, what they are going to do, they have translators, language translators are there. They are writing the research paper in Chinese, then we'll translate it in English and publish it in international journals. So that time kind of technologies are there. We can go for the teaching in mother tongue languages. Okay, and one thing is also on the teacher's part.
Right. I'll request Yadav sir, if you can quickly conclude in next 30 seconds.
Definitely, I will conclude in 30 seconds. I'm saying that most of the drafts say that students have to do this and that. And if you get 3 years, 4 years, you will get this degree and that degree. So one important aspect is that teacher have to believe in the concept of learn, unlearn and relearn. Technology is changing in a very fast way. If I am saying that I am expert today, I am expert at this technology, and later on you see that after 2 years technology just changes. So we have to learn on the regularly basis. So thanks for providing me the opportunity and to share my views, and sorry for the glitches of those PowerPoints. Sorry for that.
Thank you. Thank you, Manoji, for explaining in good detail, you know, what changes this NEP is proposing at that higher education part. You explained all those points in a wonderful way. You also, explained the impact of those changes. So big thanks, Manoj sir, for sharing those valuable insights. You. I'll come back to you with questions. Now, with this, I would request Johan Kovar sir, if you can have your ideas, your perspective.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, everybody. See, the NEP, I have gone through, and I have gone through many videos and all. But my always one doubt and confusion in that this time the government or CBSE has done well and to start that NEP after many years, but without a proper training and awareness, I believe this will also fail me. And I have seen many learned person and the principal, they are saying it's a really good and really good. I also appreciate it. But the same way, I would like to go back again in 2007, CCE pattern. When CCE pattern started, so we also accepted, we also learned, we have also gone through many trainings and all. But later on, this CCA pattern didn't continue for a long time. Then again came uniform pattern around 2016. So again, new system. Now, generally, we people always compare with other foreign countries like Finland, Japan, China. But have we seen the population of Finland? They have n number of resources, qualified teachers, trainers, n number of things they have, tools. But population-wise, we cannot compare. So in our country is simply a developing country, not developed also. So we can talk about NEP these days, going through all kind of Zoom trainings, meetings and all. But in practical, when we are going to start, then we'll come to know. Honestly, as a principal, I have gone through all this NEP. NEP I have gone through. There are n number of, it's still confusion. If you go through properly, and you can go through n number of videos also. I have gone through videos also. But it's still, till we start practically, suppose we are sitting in a Delhi NCR, Bombay NCR, or in abroad also, we can start with the help of the technology, with the help of the trainers and all. But there are many government schools in village area. I don't believe that they are going to, they can apply. That's why technology support also require, and up to what extent we are going to get technology support, that's very important. So my in my short, training requires, and then we must accept also new changes. We must also apply, but training requires not in through Zoom and all, but proper training, practical training required in each and every school. If we give proper training, I believe so, then we can will be successful. Otherwise, we shall be the bigger failure this time also, because all the principal, they are talking NEP and all, and still we are not sure when we are going to start the NEP, and still we have not got any kind of proper documentation. So in book wise or NEP new policy wise, fine, government also taking initiative. Earlier government didn't take proper initiative, this time also taking initiative, but my doubt will remain same. Whether we will be successful or not, it will come after a few years only, but we should try, we should accept new policies and all. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Johan sir. Today, I believe everyone is, instead of going for subjective answers, going for the objective responses. Big thanks, Johan sir. Absolutely. Rajesh sir said in the beginning, you also shared similar views that CCE is a good example. We need to learn from our mistakes, during the CCE part. We need to train our teachers. We need to, create mass awareness. And I believe that, this goes up in as an advantage to NEB, that it has already created that mass awareness. Now, a lot of people are talking about it. CCE lagged at that part. We did not try to create mass awareness. We did not try to create, I would say, include our parents and, all the educators to understand the benefits of CCE. So big thanks, Johan sir. I'll come back to you with questions.
Thank you.
And now I would request Jaswinder sir, if you can have your perspective.
Yeah, thank you so much. And good afternoon, everybody. The clock just went across the noon part. So good afternoon to everybody. In today's session, we had Dr. Rajesh Sharma talk about teachers training. Johan sir too talked about teachers training. Sudipta ma'am, you did talk about content-based teaching and learning. We had Gupta sir talk about, mother tongue and all. These somewhere they touch the kind of industry that I come from. So my first point that I want to talk about is, let's understand this is a disruptive policy. Disruptive in a positive way, if you look at it positively, right? So understand there's a lot that this policy is trying to do. Imagine it has come after 34 years, and the world has changed 10 times in the last 34 years. Education has changed beyond. Teaching learning methodologies have changed. The first thing is that we will have to adopt to the new ways of teaching learning, because this policy talks about new ways of delivering education. So first and foremost, we will have to integrate technology in every part of learning and teaching. So if we talk about teachers training, because as Johan sir did talk about it, ma'am talked about it, Rajesh Sharma sir talked about it, that teacher training is very important. Yes, it is. But how do we train 14 million teachers? Johan sir, 14 million teachers is what we have in our country. How do we train them? It is not possible to do it in person, though we have enough time. So the first point is that we need to first train our teachers in the use of technology. They have to be trained on how to find and locate and filter out the information that is already there available on the internet. We need to train them on technology tools, whether it is a teacher from the city, tier one city, tier two cities, tier three city, or a village. Technology, see, very soon, if telephones have, if electricity has reached each and every village in a country, so would internet be, because the private operators are taking it to that level. So internet, though, is the cheapest in India, across the world, we have the cheapest internet. If these simple devices like tablets or smartphones are provided to these teachers, where they are trained on how to use technology, they will first be able to learn on themselves. Here we are talking about, let's teach students using technology, but first teachers have to be made, comfortable with technology. Understand one very important thing. We are trying to teach this new generation, which knows much more than what we know. We will never be able to scope up with their pace. Understand one thing, Sudipta ma'am, we all need to understand that we are technology migrants, us, our generation. And the current generation is a technology resident. They were born with mobile phones and in the labs, right? So for them, this is a part of life. But us teachers, we have just shifted from using chalk and talk and the brick and mortar system. And then now we are coming to technology. So first foremost, we need to get to know how to use the tools. We need not know coding. We're not going to do all that. But how do I use technology to make my teaching learning material accessible to me? Because I need to know more than the child. That is what is expected. But the other thing is, we have to stop being a sage on the stage. And now we have to become facilitators. Because we will never be able to get to know the kind of things that students know. So how do we deliver in the class? How do we get that? The first thing is there when we are talking about experiential learning, right? Ma'am, you talked about which it should not be content-based. It should be something else, knowledge-based, information-based. So if we implement the flipped classroom system, that will take care of a lot of things. Understand, and let me give you an example. Say if today I go into the class and say, okay, I'm going to talk about volcanoes today, and I start downloading or giving all that I know, the students are just going to listen. It's going to be a one-way interaction. That may not be very successful. But if I tell my students, you answer, if I tell my students that tomorrow I'm going to talk about volcanoes and I want each one of you to get me 10 lines, what is going to happen is they're going to go back home straight, go to the Google and look for those 10 lines. Unfortunately, they will not find those 10 lines. They will find 10,000 lines. Now comes the point, they will read through that, they should skim through that, they have to filter through them that the 10 lines that that child wants to put up. And then he comes to the school next day. Now what happens? The next day, everybody in the class gets a chance to stand up and present his or her own, whatever he's got. So first thing is, they get to know, learn presentation skills, very important. Second, communication skills, they are going to stand up and speak in front of the entire class. Third is collaborative skills. It's a peer group learning because everybody is going to collaborate. Fourth is that they will learn how to find out what is the best. Okay, they will become more creative. They will start learning how to learn on their own. And then they come up with those 10 lines, which is common to everybody or which is perfect. And all this while, what is the teacher supposed to do? She or he is supposed to be a facilitator. To make learning happen, we cannot teach anymore because this generation is not teachable. That's a learning generation. They will learn on their own. You just have to be a facilitator. For that, you need not know everything, but you need to know what is where. You need to prepare yourself because we will never be able to cope up with this generation. So first and most important thing is, let's train our teachers on simple technology tools. And then whatever training we need to give them, your answer, like you said, how do we train these people? Whatever training we need to do, we can do through portals. Teachers will be capable to go learn and they can do it at their pace, in their own time and wherever they want to do it. Because you can't expect a teacher to do this in the school. Understand one thing, the difference between the teacher that we had and the teachers today. Let me give you a simple comparison. Our teachers had 24 hours and current teachers have 24 hours. For our teachers, the curriculum used to change every decade, every 10 years. Now the curriculum changes every year. Same teacher, same 24 hours,